بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله الحسين وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك، عليكم مني جميعا سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت، وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر الأحد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين وعلى حامل لواء الحسين أبي الفضل العباس وعلى الحوراء زينب روحي لهم الفداء، واللعن الدائم على أعدائهم أجمعين إلى يوم الدين. السلام عليكم dear respected viewers ورحمة الله وبركاته. Thank you for joining us again on our final in fact night show here on the way to Karbala with our dear respected brother and my brother in Aza, Sheikh Muntazir al-Karbalai, who has come all the way from Canada to bless us with his presence and his knowledge. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, we have been blessed to serve these wonderful, wonderful nights amongst the Zuwar and the Khiddam of Imam al-Hussein, who've all contributed to the message of Abi Abdullah in one way or another. And we will throughout the show be showing you some reports also on those who have contributed in different ways. But for now, I would like to give the floor to our dear respected brother, Sheikh Muntazir al-Karbalai, who will introduce us to his topic, inshallah, and we'll get straight into the program.
Soon these images will end because it's not long left till Ziyarah of Arba'een. Tomorrow is the night of Arba'een, so we will look back on these beautiful memories and inshallah hope to relive them a different night. And honestly, there is nothing probably more exhilarating and more beautiful than serving the Zuwar. Because today I was blessed to have a chance like you did a couple days ago. I remember when I first came here, you were helping with the mokib behind us, helping the brothers make the falafel. So today I was on the other side helping distribute the falafel. And honestly, you know, when, I mean, people always, they say, you know, what fun do you Muslims have? You know, you have no alcohol, you have... I tell them, honestly, if you knew what kind of intoxication lies when you saw Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, then you would not blame us for what we...
And it's not easy, especially in these nights. You know, serving is not easy, but it is, as you said, an intoxication. You can't stop doing it.
You can't
especially
stop doing
in this weather. You know, the last couple of nights, it's cold.
It's been cold.
Really cold. Like,
you can see how my brother
Hussein
is
dressed. Cold. You know, like, we're in like 7 days. It is really cold out here, yet the service has not stopped.
No.
You know, it's in fact, people are pushing it to the max on the last day, because tomorrow night, inshallah, everyone would have reached Karbala by the will of Allah. And I hope we join them, inshallah.
Inshallah, inshallah. Yeah, basically, today there's not really anything specific we would like to speak about, but we would like to go back to the time of Ashura and speak about the moments that happened after the Shahada of Sayyid al-Shuhada, peace be upon him. And we noticed that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted the tragedy of Sayyid al-Shuhada alayhi salam to be the greatest tragedy. And in the tragedy of Karbala lies all sorts of tragedies. Tragedies of the mother and the father, tragedies of the son and the mother, son and father, tragedies of the young Qasim, for example. And all of these tragedies that occurred in Karbala. And then, of course, we see the result of these tragedies and the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also the despair of God. And we know that God does not, when we say God is angry, it doesn't mean that it's a characteristic that we share with God. When we say God was sad, does not mean it's the same sad. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala displays His sadness and His anger after the killing of Sayyid al-Shuhada with the redness of the sky. The ahadith tell us that the redness of the sky did not appear until after the Shahada of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And the believers, if they wish, I tell them to go back to there are books that are mukhalifin, the brothers from Ahl al-Sunnah have as well.
In fact, sorry, you just mentioned the books. There's a book called the Anglo-Saxon Chronicles.
Yes, yes.
It is a very, very, very old book. And in that book, no, the book has nothing to do with Karbala. It's not related to Islam or Shiaism in any way. But it was a documentation of what was happening in the time.
Yeah, it's a historical account of.
And the dates that coincide with the dates of Ashura, the actual date of Ashura, where the Imam was, when Ashura happened, it states in that book that the skies started raining blood in the UK, which is now the UK, obviously.
Yes.
So in that area, it is documented at the same time that Ashura happened, the same date, the skies began to rain blood. And I know people can't come on and say, oh, you know, this is fabricated. Because look, it's got nothing to do with Shiaism, it's got nothing to do with Ahl al-Bayt, this book.
No.
It's just a documentation of historical fact.
Yes.
And you know what? Everything, Allah is the best of plans. So everything that happens, everything that's documented, always proves what happened to Imam al-Hussein and what happened to the Ahl al-Bayt and the dhulm that happened to them.
Yes, alhamdulillah. Yeah, what I also wanted to say is that we're not the only ones as well that narrate these incidents. There's a lot of a'lam, and from these a'lam are nasibi a'lams. So those scholars from the mukhalifin side, that they're not just mukhalifin, like your normal everyday mukhalif that you might find down the street. No, there are scholars who are known for their enmity towards Ahl al-Bayt, but at the same time they have testified time and time again that the narrations have concluded to us that the redness of the sky was not known until that day. And now, in case somebody may question or somebody may want to doubt, I asked them one question. I asked them to go back to the ahadith that were narrated by Rasulullah concerning the time of Maghrib prayer. If they go back to those ahadith, when Rasulullah used to point at the time of Maghrib, all he would say is that when this reaches here, when it becomes dark, that was a sign. Whereas the ahadith that we have from Imam al-Baqir and Imam al-Sadiq, which is after the shahada of Sayyid al-Shuhada, that's the only time where the term al-Humr al-Mashriqi is ever mentioned. In those other ahadith that were narrated after Hussein ibn Ali, you find that Imam al-Sadiq, when he wishes to inform his companions on the time in which Maghrib enters, he says, Zawad al-Humr al-Mashriqiyya. Zawad al-Humr al-Mashriqiyya is when the redness of the sky, when it begins, as soon as it reaches the midpoint of the sky, that's when Maghrib period starts. So that's also another indication that even the ahadith themselves from both sides tell us that this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala displayed His anger. Then elsewhere you have the aza of the skies and the heavens and the earth raining blood for 40 days, for example. I mean, last time I remember talking to one of my friends, this may sound, people may hear me right now and they say, maybe this guy is going crazy, but I'm going to say it anyways. We know that there are specific angels that are responsible for bringing down water, okay, from the skies when it rains. Now, the sky raining blood can be two things. Either the angels themselves have a container where they are spilling blood, or the angels themselves must be spilling their own blood and it's mixing with the rain and falling down. I mean, in a way we can say the angels are performing their own tatbir in the heavens during that time period. Then you also have the rock that's turned over and you find fresh blood, the same sign that was found with Yahya ibn Zakariya, John the Baptist, in which that blood continued to boil until Bakhat Nasr came and he killed over 60,000 people until that blood stopped boiling. And the blood of Sayyid al-Shuhada till today boils, of course, because Sahab al-Asr wa Zaman has not yet come to seek vengeance for Sayyid al-Shuhada. I mean, all of these events that happen after the martyrdom of Sayyid al-Shuhada, they're all connected to how grand the musibah was. I mean, yes, the killing of Sayyid al-Shuhada is the greatest musibah. But then, the problem after that, and this is why I have these papers here today, I've been translating. It was difficult to translate, but it has to be said. People have to know these names. People have to know these events. People have to connect with Sayyid al-Shuhada more and more. We want them to be as close as they can to the Imam alayhi salam. I mean, I narrated this from Masar al-Shahada, volume 3, page 123, from there onwards. And we're going to go into a report soon, or should we keep on going?
I suggest if we're going to go into this, we'll go to report.
Yeah, no problem.
In return, so we're not cut off. So, yes, again, we do have daily reports. Today we have two very special reports, one on the security surrounding the walk and the Zawar of Muhammad Hussein, and one around the medical supplies and the medical facilities. So I believe the team has prepared a report for you. The first report will be on the security surrounding the Zawar of Muhammad Hussein. So we'll return after that, inshallah. Security here on the way to Imam Hussein is very tight, and they are making sure that the Zawar of Imam Hussein are safe and secure and have no security worries on their mind, and the mind is clear towards Abu Abdullah Hussein. They need not worry about anything. As I have mentioned before, they don't want to worry about food, about sleep, about cleanliness, and don't even need to worry about security, because the security here is tight and are at every corner. Now, the soldiers that are sent here, they're not only Shia. There's a few of the soldiers we spoke to earlier, you know, some of them are Sunni, some of them are Shia, and they're here voluntarily. Because if you are assigned a place, you don't have to stick to it, according to them. He's saying he chose to come and serve the Zawar of Muhammad Hussein and to ensure that they are safe and secure. Now, alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, this tells us that Imam Hussein is the one that unites us, and no one else. There is no other figure worldly that unites us on this road. Only Imam Hussein, only that man at the end of the road. And that is proven by figures like this telling us that I am from a different school of thought, I have a different belief system. But this man, he sacrificed for humanity, and it's our duty to protect his guests. And we thank Allah for creating people like this to protect the Zawar of Muhammad Hussein. And we ask Allah that we are able to protect the Zawar and serve the Zawar to this extent also. If you want to be more wise, listen and take. If you want to be more wise, listen and take my advice. Listen to me. We are now joined by one of the soldiers here protecting the Zawar of Muhammad Hussein. Inshallah, we will take his insights on what is happening and from his point of view, how they see the atmosphere of the ziyarah of Imam Hussein. Assalamu alaikum. Shalom sahibkum. Allah khalikum. I'd like to ask you some questions if it's not a problem. Do you know what is your importance in this season, this ziyarah? What is your duty to be here? Allah is the one who is the one who is He's saying that they are here to serve the Zawar of Muhammad Hussein in general and serve all the pilgrims and those who serve the pilgrims here on the route to Karbala. He's saying maximum 10 days, but it's been definitely over a week. Of course, the amount of work they put in, one forgets how many days they've been here because, you know, constantly you are working in different areas, you are moving non-stop, and there's always pressure on you. So it's understandable for one to forget the amount of days they have been working. Then حجينا انتو لا زائرين لا اصحاب موكب انتو شغلتكم امنية الزوار صح؟
أمن وسلامة الزائر.
من تشوفون هالمشاية وهالأجواء مع المشاية شو تحسون أنتم؟ يعني كل واحد له غير إحساس، الزائر له إحساس خصوصية، والخادم بالموكب عنده إحساس. أنت من تشوف هاي الأجواء شو تفكر شو تحس؟
فرحة وحزن بنفس الوقت، وما أحلى من خدمة الزائرين كمان.
So he's saying, I asked him, of course, the Zair Imam Hussein, he feels something different when he's walking. The Khadim in the Malkib feels something different as well. So I asked him, what do you, as someone who takes care of the security of the Zawar, of the pilgrims, what do you feel? What kind of atmosphere do you live? He says, when I look at the Zawar, I see pleasure, happiness, and sadness at the same time. So he's, so if you want to elaborate on that, he's saying, I see the happiness that they are here visiting Imam al-Hussein. They are here visiting Aba Abdullah. They have come and walked the footsteps of Zainab. And sadness because when you walk the footsteps of Zainab, you remember the pain and the anguish that they went through. On that note, I'd like to thank them for making sure we are safe and making sure the Zawar reach Karbala safely. Shukran jazeeran ala ta'awunkum ma'a al-Zawar wa ala amniyat al-Zawar. Allah bikum.
With every choice you make, remember them, a brother, and stay awake. Remember.
Welcome back, dear viewers, from that report on the security around the Zawar of Imam al-Hussein. We will now return to the Sheikh and the topic we were talking about and the masaib we were talking about. So inshallah, I'll hand it over to you.
Inshallah,
Sheikh.
Inshallah. I just thought of something before I do begin, and just before we start reading this, is an important thing to say. Also back to the majalis, the majalis that we uphold. I want to say that we should be very careful and try our best to try to revive these majalis on their dates. I know it's difficult for some people, for example, that have work or that have other events that they have to be in, other responsibilities. The only reason is that when you revive something on the night of, on the day of, you give it more importance. And when the believers are sitting there and the Khatib is speaking to them, he can actually connect them more to the events at hand. And the only reason I'm saying this is that after this Arba'een, we go through 10 more days and then, or 8 more days, and the believers, I mean, those who do not know about this, the believers will start walking this way. So now they're going to go walk to the soul of Rasulullah, Amir al-Mumin alayhi salam. He's the closest thing to Rasulullah. So the believers walk to Imam Ali alayhi salam because they're denied from going to Rasulullah's grave. Or honestly, if they had the opportunity, they would walk to Rasulullah's grave all the way in Medina, the believers. So, but I'm still not there to my actual point. My actual point is following the istishhad of Rasulullah. The most important events that paved the path to all the oppression that we have today began. On the 3rd of Rabi' is when the Saqifah Bani Sa'ada occurred. On the 4th and 5th of Rabi' was the ferocious attack on the house of Sayyidah Fatima alayhi salam by the order of Abu Bakr ibn Abi Quhafa. And also the tragic event that happened between the door and the nail with Sayyidah Fatima. That's happened on the 5th of Rabi'. Because when we usually do the Fatimiyat, which is either the first, second, or third Rawaya, the first Rawaya, which is 45 days after the Shahada of Rasulullah, second 75, third 95 days. That's the day in which Sayyidah Fatima passed away. That's when her soul left her body. But the events that led to her soul leaving her body actually happened on the 3rd and 4th and 5th of Rabi'. So I tell my dear brothers and sisters that are listening to us today, if you can connect the Shahada of Rasulullah all the way until the 8th of Rabi'. Meaning what? You mean you will cover all the way until the attack on the door of Fatima. Then after that, 5, 6, 7, 8, you prepare for the istishhad Imam Hassan al-Askari alayhi salam. Then on the 9th of Rabi, you'll have Farhat al-Zahra. This is an idea that I have in mind, and I'm trying to make it go back in our community in Ottawa, in Canada. But this is something that I hope the believers do.
We need to remember the masab of the Ahlul Bayt, of course. We need to not just give one night where we are all free, you know. We need to push ourselves. We need to show that we have put effort in. Not, you know, we're free on Friday, let's do it on Friday.
Yes.
No, the day of the Shahada. The Imam did not pass away on Friday. Don't do the Shahada on Friday. Pass away on Wednesday, do the Shahada on Wednesday. That's how you truly commemorate the sacrifices of the Ahlul Bayt.
Yes. And the only reason I'm putting emphasis on these Rabi'a 3, 4, 5 is because honestly we have oppressed and Muhassan alayhi salam. Why don't we have majalis where we narrate the story of the unborn child? Al-Muhassin deserves to have majalis just as grand as he is the brother of the Imam alayhi salam. He is the brother that not get to live his life, but died in the womb of Sayyidah Zahra alayhi salam.
Get to reach Karbala.
At all. And that's why we have, by the way, in our narrations and our maqatil, that Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam had an infant that was born on Karbala whom he called Muhassin, which is different from the Abdullah al-Radi' that died in his hands. This Muhassin died while the Imam was still holding him when he was taking it from Sayyidah Zainab, and he was also struck with an arrow. People always forget this other child of Imam alayhi salam. I mean, and now people are going to say, well, hadith is weak. First, let them, I only have one question to ask anybody who would doubt these. Is first, I want you to prove to me how many exact sons and daughters Imam had, which there's differences between all the ulama for 1,000 years now. Nobody has given us a number. In fact, they say the Imam has at least 8 daughters and at least 6 sons, maximum. Minimum wise, 4 boys and 4 daughters, minimum wise. So these events must be remembered.
And they look, if there's a possibility, a slight possibility that it happened, even if it was at the weakest riwayah, let's assume. But the fact that there is that possibility, why would you choose not to mourn? Why would you choose to not commemorate? If that chance is there, that there's a possibility that the Imam was oppressed in a certain way, you know, there's a possibility that there's a shahada that has taken place that you have forgotten. Why not commemorate it?
Exactly.
Even if you are assuming it's weak riwayat, which most of the time it's not when it comes to the shahada, but let's assume it is. Who cares? And then you're commemorating the shahada of an infallible, a member of the Ahlul Bayt, a loved one by the Ahlul Bayt, whoever it may be. Please, brothers and sisters, and I want to emphasize more on what you said, Sheikhna.
Please go ahead. Thank you very much.
We need to commemorate the shahadat of our loved ones. The same way, God forbid, if a parent of yours died, we wouldn't commemorate their death a week later. We'd commemorate it on the day, on the anniversary of the death. Is Aba Abdullah not worth more to us than our parents? Or is it just words that we say? Are we not... Can we not act upon our words when we say bi-abi anta wa ummi ya Aba Abdullah? This is Aba Abdullah al-Hussein, you know. I don't know what more I can add on to that, Sheikhna, but...
No, you said what we wanted to say. I mean, that's why, I mean, I did not, this was not planned for. But all of a sudden I remembered the loneliness and the emptiness of the majalis of Sayyidina Aziz al-Muhassin alayhi salam. السبت الثالث السقط الذي سقط من عند فاطمة الزهراء عليه السلام the one who fell from the womb of Fatima عليه السلام who did not see the light of day. You know, I just remembered him right now. The only reason I remembered him is because today I saw a young Zair with their son, and then I asked for the son's name, and they said Al-Muhassin, and then all of a sudden brought me back memories from Muharram, where one of the brothers recited a qasida, which was a conversation between Abdullah al-Radi' and al-Muhassin, each one narrating their tragedies back to each other. The poet put it so beautifully, and it just really, really rips your heart apart. So inshallah, this year, we can have nights, we call them al-Muhassin nights, you know, and then other nights as well, we should commemorate with as much as we can. And again as well, especially Imam al-Hasan al-Mujtaba. I know his Shahada passed, and always, it's every single year. And I say this in concerning my own center as well, because that's these are, I've lived with them. It's unfortunate that the majalis are so empty. Whereas Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam, Imam al-Hussein takes pride in saying that my brother is better than me. My brother taught me courage. My brother taught me knowledge. It's very important that the same way we say al-Hussein ajannani, al-Hasan also ajannani.
Of course.
So, inshallah.
Imam al-Hasan is mazloom.
Truly mazloom. Truly mazloom
by his own
Shia and his non-Shia. And he's buried in Baqi' to at least Sayyid al-Shuhada alayhi salam. Everybody goes to the ziyarah of Sayyid al-Shuhada. The Christian goes, the Jew goes, the Shi'i goes, the non-Shi'i goes.
Al-Hasan inshallah, the minarets of Imam al-Hasan will soon rise. With Imam al-Sadiq, Imam al-Baqir, and Imam, all the Imam buried in Baqi' and Umm al-Baneen. Let us not forget Umm al-Baneen. The mother of the four. You know, let us pray, and we prayed now to Allah that not only the minarets but the domes rise above their graves, and we were all granted the chance not only to visit but perform the Aza of Latum and more near their graves inshallah in the near future. But on that note, Sheikhna, we'll go to a quick break with the report. And again, these reports are there to give you a better image of what is happening on the way to Karbala. And this is our final report for this show, inshallah, because this is our last show. So please enjoy the report, and inshallah it is beneficial for you, and we will return after the break.
Dedicated before they died, and for the holy name of Allah they tried. They mixed their blood with the thunder. They will never miss.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum, dear viewers, wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Every day we look at a different aspect of the war, something new that we have seen, or something that we feel is important for the world to see. Today, you'll probably come across the most important thing that one can do in service to Imam al-Hussein. Behind me is a medical tent, and it is one of four or five medical tents in the same area. They have thought about every department that you'd find in a hospital, and have set it up here on the way to Imam al-Hussein, ensuring that there is no cases, there aren't any cases that they can't deal with. Whether it's women's cases, whether it's children, there are pediatrics, whether they need a pharmacy to have a tent set up with all the medicines that you need. Whether it's general cuts, bruises, or if someone passes out and faints, they can deal with it. And even if there are cases of emergency, they have set up a connection with the hospital not far from here, where they send ambulances to cut through all the human traffic and send any serious cases there. And alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, there are tents like this all over the walk. Every couple of hundred poles, there are more tents like this to ensure the safety and security of the zuwar. And we thank Allah that there are people like this who think about these certain aspects, and they make sure that, you know, every aspect of the walk is covered, every detail, every small thing that you might need is provided. So in that case, in this case, we'll go inside and we'll speak to one of the doctors, inshallah, and get more of an insight on what is happening and the ins and outs of running a medical tent. So join us, inshallah.
Their intentions are so pure. That is what I am hoping for. Their intentions are so pure. They will always stand strong, they will never hide. They will always stand strong, they will never hide.
We're now here with one of the assistant doctors on the way to Karbala from Najaf, and we'll ask him a few questions to get an insight on the وقت تستنى ان شاء الله. السلام عليكم.
عليكم السلام.
خلينا بس كم سؤال نسال، شنو هي الخدمات اللي قدموها هنا بالمفرزات الطبيه؟
بالنسبه للخدمات الموجوده في طريق نجف كربلاء، عندنا مفرزه طبيه من كل الفروع موجوده، عندنا ضمات، قسم ضمات، وعندنا قسم صيدله، بالاضافه الى عندنا اطباء موجودين، اطباء اطفال، اطباء باطنيه.
You're saying that they have every department at each general hospital here on the road to Karbala all set up in these tents that we are sitting in. You're saying they have a pharmacy tent across the road, they have a pediatrician across the road, they have a women's section just for women, and they have specific doctors for each department, and then a whole team of assistant doctors, and they take care of anything that Zahir wants, anything the pilgrim wants, from minor cuts and bruises, to any stresses and strains, to any, you know, cuts on the feet from the walking. And they take care of all these issues, and then they send the Zawar on the way to Imam Hussein, making sure they are in the best of health, and then they get there without any worries, inshallah. Then, أنتوا تعتبروها هاي خدمة للحسين لو خدمة للمجتمع، شنو تفكرون من تجون مسؤول، شنو يدفعكم مسؤول شيء خيام؟
أكيد إحنا خدمة للإمام الحسين، أكيد يعني بالضبط، وخدمة للزائرين. شعارنا شنو؟ شعارنا خدمة الحسين شرفنا، فإحنا نخدم الزوار زائرين الإمام الحسين. أكيد يا نية نحن موجودة للإمام الحسين أكيد.
He's saying for sure that our intention is to serve Imam Hussein, and in fact our slogan is the service of Hussein is our honor. So whatever we do here is in service of Imam Hussein and his guests and his pilgrims. So without a doubt, yes, all this work is for Imam Hussein and no other reason. So he's saying first aid and basic healing and stuff, yeah, they do definitely. But if there is a case, and there has been many cases of, for example, one of the servants here cutting their fingers by accident while they were cooking, or any broken limbs, or you know, if someone passed out to an extent where they can't revive him here, then they have contact with the Mustashfa of Imam Hussein in Karbala, and they actually have 7 ambulances from the 7 Isafat. So he has 5 ambulances here parked not far. And if there are any cases like this, and in addition to this, the ambulances, they call them straight away and they send them straight into the hospital in Karbala without any problems. So they've taken care of all the issues that might occur. And he says, in addition to all this, we have big refrigerators to take care of all the medicine, to make sure that they are nice and cool. And to back them up, there are generators also, to make sure that these refrigerators are on constantly 24/7. And I'd like to thank them and then ask Allah to bless them and allow them to work further in service of Hussein. Nushkurkum jazeeran wa adam Allah ajrakum. Shukran. Allah khairukum.
Bikul khadamat Imam Hussein.
Saying,
Allah khairukum.
He's saying we are at the service of all the servants of Imam Hussein. He thanks us also for spreading the name of Imam Hussein to the world. And we thank him for his kind words. Salaam.
Allah, they try. Fighters who dedicated before they die, and for the holy name of.
Welcome back again, dear viewers. That was our last, unfortunately, our last report on this show, our night show on the road to Karbala. But now that we are back, inshallah, we will continue and hopefully shed a tear,
inshallah,
for the oppressed ones, the oppressed Ahlul Bayt. And inshallah, Sheikh Muntazir Karbala will bring us that tear. So I hand it over to you, Sheikh.
Inshallah, inshallah. So today we want to we want to narrate some of the horrific events that happened after the Shahada of Hussein ibn Ali, when they went to his body and they began to loot whatever was there from Sayyidi Shuhada's body. They did not leave anything except what they took, of course. And that's why in the Maqtar we read that before Sayyidi Shuhada left, he asked Sayyidi Zainab alayhi salam, Ya Ukhta, I'tini qamisi al-khashin. Bring me my shirt that is coarse, my shirt that is thick, that is not appealing to the eyes, so that after I die they will not loot me and let me wear it under my armor, under my vest and under my shirt. But of course even that they took, and we're just going to read you some of what happened. And I read these from the Nusus. It says that his shirt was taken by Ishaq al-Hadrami. He wore it and became paralyzed and his hair fell off. And it has been narrated that on the shirt of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, there was more than 100 wounds, more than 100 cuts from swords and spears. His sarawin, his pants, they were taken by a man called Bahar ibn Ka'b al-Tamimi. And it was narrated that he wore it and he lived the rest of his life not able to walk on his feet. So everything that they took from Sayyid al-Shuhada, these enemies of Sayyid al-Shuhada, they right away they saw the effects before the hereafter. His burnus, the burnus is the long garment that is usually worn under the shirt. It was taken by a man named Malik ibn Yazid al-Kindi. When he came back to his wife, he began washing the blood from it. His wife said to him, "You bring into my house the looted shirt of the Prophet's son, leave me. May God fill your grave with fire." After that, he raised his hand trying to hit his wife, and then he missed his wife and he hit the nail on the door, and it said that his hand got cut off. And it was not long after that Al-Mukhtar ibn Ahmad Allah al-Thaqafi burned him in this dunya before the Akhirah. His sandals were taken by Al-Aswad ibn Khalid. His ring was taken by Bujdan ibn Salim al-Kalbi, who cut off his finger in order to get to him. His sword was taken by a man from Banu Tamim named Aswad ibn Hanbala. And his sword, of course, was not the same with Al-Fiqar, because that was given to Am Salama, that Ali ibn Hussein would later inherit. I mean, so on and so forth, of course. And the most destructive of all these stories, and there's no time to narrate all these stories, is that his tabka, the Imam alayhi salam had a belt that he would wrap his shirt, that he would wrap around. And this belt is called the tabka. There's a man by the name of Al-Jammal. He's known by Al-Jammal. Al-Jammal was the caretaker of the camels of Sayyid al-Shuhada. This man narrates himself his story. He says, "I was in Sa'd ibn al-Musib says, I saw this man holding the walls of the Kaaba as he was saying, 'Oh Allah, forgive me, I know you will not forgive me. Allah, forgive me, I know you will not forgive me.' When they saw him, they asked him, 'What is wrong with you? You are in the house of God. How can Allah not forgive you?' He said, 'I did something so horrific that Allah will never forgive me.' He said, 'I swear to you, tell me, what did you do?' He said, 'I am the Jamal of Sayyid al-Shuhada. I am the one who used to take care of his camels. When Sayyid al-Shuhada would go for wudu, I would look at his tekka, his belt, and it was so beautiful, so elegant. I had my eyes on it. I had my eyes on it. On the day of Ashura, when all of the bodies were laid on the floor and all the heads were severed, I placed myself between the bodies, pretending I was dead until Umar ibn Sa'd's army left. And I began to walk on the plains of Karbala. I began to walk on the plains of Karbala, looking to my left, looking to my right. I'm looking for the tekka, the belt of Sayyid al-Shuhada. And then I see a nur illuminating from the body of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. I see a nur coming from the body of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, and I see him there. The belt was still there. Nobody took the belt. I want to ask Al-Jammal, why did you not ask Sayyid al-Shuhada for the belt? Sayyid al-Shuhada is from Ahl al-Karam. He's a generous one. He's the son of Rasulullah. He would have given you the belt. This is the part that hurts the most. I apologize to Sahab al-Asr wa al-Zaman for narrating this. He began trying to untie the belt of Sayyid al-Shuhada. When he was untying the belt of Sayyid al-Shuhada, Sayyid al-Shuhada with no head put his hand on Al-Jammal's, and he tried to remove the hand of Sayyid al-Shuhada, but the hand would not remove. He said, "I found a piece of a sword on the floor. I took the piece of the sword and began cutting off his right hand. After I finished cutting off his right hand, I went back to the knot to untie the knot. Sayyid al-Shuhada put on his left hand. The gap. He was in the same zone. He took it on his left hand. Sayyid al-Fadl al-Abbas was not the only one with no hands on Karbala. Sayyid al-Shuhada as well had no hands on Karbala. All because this man wanted a belt, a belt. My dear brothers and sisters, this is the dunya. Do not attach yourselves to the dunya. This man sold his akhirah for the dunya, for a belt. When you could have just went to Sayyid al-Shuhada and asked Sayyid al-Shuhada for the belt, and I'm pretty sure Imam al-Hussein would have given him the belt the same way he would give water to his enemies.
إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. إن شاء الله the enemies of the Ahlul Bayt will get their day soon, and the blood of Aba Abdullah will be avenged by Imam Sahib al-Asr wal-Zaman. We'd like to thank you, Sheikhna, for your masa'ib and for your insights during these very holy nights. But unfortunately, this is and this was our last show here on the way to Karbala at this time. But inshallah, tomorrow we have one more afternoon show at 4 p.m. Iraq time, which is 1 p.m. GMT time.
This just before we conclude, since we're going to be going to Karbala tomorrow, inshallah, and I also told the believers, consists right now, the people that are living in Europe, they're watching us, and the people that are living in America are too late to watch us. So those who are watching us right now, if you want to be remembered in Karbala, tell them to send in their names and their requests, either on Facebook, either on YouTube, either on Twitter, so we can create a list, and inshallah, we'll be able to place it on the shrine, inshallah.
Inshallah, inshallah. It's a very important thing, brothers and sisters, again, to reiterate what the Sheikh just said. If you do have any special du'as or you'd like us to mention you by name, please message into one of the many ways you can message the channel, through Facebook, YouTube, Twitter. There are many ways. So we can write your names and put it in an envelope, inshallah, and put it in the shrine, just as we did during Muharram. So again, join us tomorrow for our final afternoon show also at 4 p.m. Iraq time and 1 p.m. GMT time. But for this night show, with the Sheikh being our guest, unfortunately this is our last night. So not much more I can say, but we ask you to pray for us,
inshallah.
And pray for the reappearance of the Imam, and pray for Hajj al-Sha'bi, the boys who are giving their lives to protect the shrines. And wassalamu alaikum.
Wassalamu alaikum.